Hi, good morning. I'll try to do that without my eyeglasses. Today we're going to talk about three things. The first thing we're talking about is this part. This part is the stator of a ceiling fan alternator. It's not easy to get to it. It's even harder to take measurements of this circle. So we will not be dealing with this section of the ceiling fan. We will strictly restrict ourselves to the other two parts. One of them is the rotor. If you have watched my video entitled Ceiling Fan Alternate Rotor Removal, you know how to take it out. I'll take this one out. The rotor is a ring of metal, and I won't go any deeper into it. They come in different shapes. Sometimes they look like this, sometimes they have little extensions all around. But basically, once you remove that rotor, you're left with a circular path. And in that circular path, you have to add magnets. And that's the problem we will try to solve today, all right? I don't know if I'll see you again, but I'll definitely give you a solution for this one. Thank you. All right, let me restate the problem a little clearer. Here you start with a ceiling fan motor. The first thing you do, you remove the cover. And as I mentioned before, you can watch some videos of me or other people doing it. Here we go. I just pulled out one half of the cover. And you have this wonderful geometric design looking at you. The next thing you do, you remove the rotor. The rotor is right here, so I think I can pull it with one hand. I'm holding the camera with the other hand. I think I have to shake it a little bit to get it loose. It's coming up. I think it takes two hands, so I put the camera down and remove the rotor. See if I can still put it in view. Here we go. With two hands, I just pull it, and here it goes. The rotor is off. The other side of the cover is off, and the rotor is off. Put that upside down like this. At this point, you're looking at a circular path, right? All around here, where you have to put magnets. The problem is, unlike manufacturers of motors that have their magnet custom made with the right curvature, as in the example of this permanent magnet motor right here. If we take a look at it, my hand's a little shaky, but that's okay. And we look inside and we'll see curved magnets. And that's the story of it. They make magnets of the right curvature to fit all around the motor enclosure. Eventually, when ceiling fan manufacturers catch up with the trend of ceiling fan alternators, they will be making these magnets. But in the meantime, let's make sure this shows that it's a magnet. I am putting a screwdriver there, and pretty soon the screwdriver is pulled either to one side or the other. All right, so the screwdriver is standing up by itself. We have magnets in there. With or ceiling fan, however, we have to put rectangular magnets here. I made an illustration of it. I exaggerated the gap. When I talk about gap, I'm talking about the distance between the air gap, which is blue, and the motor cover. And we know there's the stator, and there's a little blue air gap there in between, without which the rotor won't be able to rotate. If it's touching the stator, you're out of luck. And what we remove in that space from that blue line to the outer blue line, from the air gap circle, the stator is everything that's white in there. This is the space that the rotor occupies, which tells us that the rotor has all the information that we need. All right, the thickness of the rotor, we will need that. We'll call that the distance, the rotor distance, also known as DR. Anyways, you take a caliper and you measure that, the thickness of the rotor. That we're going to use, because I'm going to give you an equation at the end that will relate the length of the magnet that will fit in that space, and it will tell you how wide the magnet, that magnet for a given length, it will tell you how wide the magnet has to be. It will relate L to W. So our job is to build that equation, but we will need some measurements. The first measurement is the distance between these two circles, also known as the rotor distance, which is basically the thickness from outside to inside. The difference, the space between the outside diameter of the rotor and the inside diameter of the rotor. That's what we call the rotor distance. The next thing you will know, you will need to find the circumference, right? You need to find the circumference of the outside circle here in this rotor, right? The reason why you need it, because our formula will be based on the radius of the large circle and the radius of the small circle. The radius of the large circle we will call R2, and the radius of the small circle we will call R1. So first you find the circumference of the large circle. Then you divide that by pi, and that gives you the diameter of the large circle. And you divide that by 2, and here you have R2. All right? And once you find R2, and you already have the distance, the rotor distance, which is the thickness from outside to inside, you subtract that from R2, and you get R1. So R1 is the radius of what? It's the radius of the inside circle of this rotor, which is the same radius of the stator plus the air gap. So R1 is not the radius of the stator. All right? R1 is the radius of the stator plus the air gap, right? So R1 is this inside circle. So basically, if we want to talk a little abstract, we'll say that the inside circle of the rotor makes contact with the air gap. Why not? That's a friction-free contact, almost, anyways. So that's not what interests us. So we clearly define what R1 is, and we clearly define what R2 is. Now our job is to work an equation that will let you know what shape magnet will fit in there without diminishing the gap that the manufacturer of the motor established. And also without making the gap any wider than it was initially. So you're looking at this table here, right? And you see there are different size rectangles, but notice that they are all wedged against the air gap and the motor cover, which is the motor cover is that line outside. This one is wedged between the air gap, blue line here, and the motor cover outside. So these two rectangles are not identical. This one also is wedged, and it has different dimensions. All four of them have different dimensions. The first mistake that people make is they say, okay, I have an air gap here, right? I mean, not an air gap, a rotor distance here. And as you can see, I have this little cardboard square, and it shows me that it fits perfectly. All right, the length of each side is as long as the thickness of the rotor, right? Then you say, okay, if I buy a square magnet like this, and let's see, I can just fit them here. And you buy these square magnets, and look what happened. They are against the motor cover, then you run into problems there. You are way past the air gap into stator territory. So it's clear to me that I cannot use a magnet as wide as this. But the edge is fitting. Yes, the edge is a measurement of distance, and you call that a line segment. A line segment virtually has no thickness. But once you make it wider than a line, then watch what happens. Here we have a little gap left there, almost invisible. As we increase the width of the rectangle, that little gap gets bigger. We are here in a square situation, and the little gap is even bigger. And when we get to this one, you can see I had space to write W there with two arrows. So the wider the magnet, the more the curve, motor cover, will push it forward. So basically, we have a puzzle. And to solve this puzzle, we're going to work together in the next few minutes. Hold on. I am back with this drawing. That's the best I could do for the drawing of the stator. The air gap that's clearly visible here. Well, the original air gap of the manufacturer is the smaller distance between the rectangular magnet and the circle. And as you can see, that distance widens as the magnets get wider. So we have 14 of them, and you know that a circle encloses 360 degrees. So we will take 14 slices of pizza, each with a central angle of 360 divided by 14, whatever that may be. I know what it is, but let's not mention it. I think you should get used to remembering it in that form, 360 divided by 14. Okay, let me pull another design, which is below this one. Here is another design here. This is one of these slices that I just mentioned. The angle is the magnet, the textured blue tall magnet that I put there. I definitely exaggerated the distance from the motor cover to the air gap, all right? And the air gap is made big here as well with this big, thick blue line. So I have my magnet that's wedged here. And the rays of this angle to the left and to the right, the sides of the angle make contact with the sides of the magnet. Having said that, we know that each magnet occupies an angle that's 360 divided by 14. Therefore, if we bisect this angle, we get half that amount, and that amount is 360 divided by 28. Okay, that's half the size of the angle taken by each magnet at half the size of the slices, the 14 slices that we originally got. Now, the bisector of this angle intercepts the short side W of the magnet at its midpoint. Okay, we do it in such a way. We can draw radii at any angle. We draw it in a way that it intercepts the width of the magnet at its midpoint. Therefore, we have a 90 degree angle there. Because of that, we know that to the right we have half the width, which is W over 2, right? W over 2, in this case, we're going to use W over 2 and this angle and R1, the radius of the stator plus the air gap. You know that tangent is equal to the opposite, the side opposite to the angle over the side adjacent to that angle. So W over 2 is equal to the tangent of 360 over 28 is equal to W over 2 divided by R1. Alright, and that's what we're going to use to find out. First, we're going to compare that with something else. Let me explain. So we know that W over 2 over R1 is the tangent of this angle here. So if we multiply both sides by W over 2, actually we multiply both sides by R1, we get W over 2 is equal to R1 times the tangent of this angle. W over 2 equals R1 times the tangent of this angle. And that gives us half of W over 2. So to find the complete width of the magnet, we multiply by 2. So we have W is equal to 2 R1 times the tangent of 360 over 28. All right. What does that tell us? It gives us a measurement, and let us compare to the measurement of this arc here. We know that R1 is the radius, and we know that 2 times the radius is the diameter. So we go 2 times R1 times pi is the circumference of this circle. That's the air gap circle, okay? I mean, not, yeah, the circumference, the distance all around. We divide that by 14, and you'll find out that when you divide it by 14, it is shorter than W. So to be on the safe side, I will use that pi times 2R1 divided by 14 as the maximum width that I will allow my magnets to have, just to be on the safe side, all right? And now we have to figure out how we relate the width to the length. Hold on. Hey, in this drawing, you can clearly see that the maximum width, W, is definitely larger than 2 pi R1 divided by 14. There are 14 magnets here, and when connected, they make a circle that is circumscribed over R1. Well, not a circle, a regular polygon with 14 sides. All right. Okay, having said that, let's move to the relationship between the relationship between the length and the width of the magnets. I sent the problem to a professor on YouTube, and he sent back this elegant solution. He said, draw a line from the center to the corner of W at the bottom. So we have two sides parallel and congruent, equal side. So I do that line, and that line is actually the radius R2. And we still have W over 2 here. W over 2. W is from left to right, and half of it is W over 2. And we have R1 that stops at the end of the blue circle here. And we add L to that. This section is parallel to this one, so this is still L. So with that in mind, we are considering the right triangle that is formed here. And R2 is the hypotenuse, therefore, it suggested the Pythagorean theorem, which we have right here. Right? It says w over 2 square plus r1 plus l square, which is right here. Okay, and that will give you r2 square. Then w over 2 square equal r2 square minus r1 plus l square. Taking square roots, we end up with w over 2 is equal to this square root, and finally multiplying by 2 on both sides, w is equal to 2 r2 square. 2 times the square root of r2 square minus r1 plus l square. And this is how it all stops today. We have found this elegant solution relating w to l. So for any given l, you can plug that l there and find out what w will be. So when you're shopping for magnets on the internet and you think that the magnet will fit because one of the sides appeals to you, it's close to the gap, find out if it's the other side of it is equal to or less than the W that you're going to find right here. So basically that's the story here, and I will put the link, I will add a link to the video. So you'll find out who exactly sent this elegant solution. Thank you. A final note, I want to say that when I construct permanent magnet alternators, there's another dimension of the magnet that comes into play. It's the height of it. The reason why I mention it is because a lot of people add a metal ring inside the motor cover for two reasons. Once they add as many layers of tin sheet metal rings to keep advancing the magnets until they get the perfect gap. All right. The other reason is once you remove the cover, you have to place the magnets at midpoint between both covers. You have to center the magnets there. That's what these little legs in the rotors were about. They were lifting the rotor to the right position. And so if you're adding a ring, it's easier to just put your magnet at the center of the ring. But you have to measure how wide that band is going to be so the cover can close once more. However, if you do it like I do it, I don't have any ring. You have to also measure to see how tall your magnets are going to be, the height of the magnets. But that's not the end of the story. I have many videos with the ceiling fan alternator that open, and the reason why is because I had difficulties putting the other cover once all the magnets were in place, since I didn't permanently put them there with resin. Even if I had used resin, it's very hard to put that cover back, so it's easier to replace the metal cover, half cover, with a plastic cover. You just find a plastic cover and you find something that fits there and you can cut the holes and you'll really, really save yourself some time. And you are not going to lose power because I have reached 230 volts with mine the way they are, and you can too. All right. This concludes that, and I'll give you a quick look at how the garden's going. These tomato plants are tall, but not producing much, and a few other things. Thank you for watching. Bye-bye.